Jimmy Smith, founder of Amusement Park.
Oh, well, first things first, y'all gotta move up. Y'all making me feel kind of weird here. So come on, let's fill up some of these seats, please. We can sit in the front of the bus now. Y'all in the back, please. So, y'all keep moving while I'm talking. So this, we started, it used to be "We're all the black people," but now that you all are here, we can say "Here are all the black people." And it started in two ways. In, I guess about 7 years ago, there's a cat named Mike Hughes who founded the Martin Agency in Virginia, one of the great legendary ad agencies. And he's passed away now, rest in peace, but he was a brilliant writer, brilliant ad man. And one of the things he said was, we were having a meeting, and he said, "Jimmy, I hire some black people. I don't have a problem with black people," and he didn't. "I just don't know where to find them." So he said, "Well, don't know where to find the black people." So that's one thing we need to solve, is figure out how we can find some black people so you can hire them. And then, and he's actually got one of the top cats over there, creative directors working now. I don't know, he might be here, actually come here today. And then Jeff Goodby, that happened. And then Jeff Goodby, how many people know who Jeff Goodby is? Okay. For those who didn't raise your hand, that's one of the first things you want to do, is know your history. So you want to know who Jeff Goodby is, you want to know who Lee Clow is, you know, you want to make like Kobe Bryant and know the history of whatever profession you're in. Very important. And then, anyway, Jeff was having a Christmas party, and he's one of the founders of Goodby Silverstein. And he was having a Christmas party in San Fran. And this cat named Ed Creighton, young brother at the time, writer. And Jeff was drinking a beer at his Christmas party. And Ed walked up to him and said, "Yo, Jeff, where are all the black people?" And that caught brother Jeff off guard. And he was like, yeah, that's right. We don't have any black people. Probably need to change that. So he called me up one day and said, "You know, we should, he told me that story, and he said, "We should do something about that." And I said, "Absolutely. Been working on it for a minute." And I told him my story with Mike Hughes. And then you guys have this organization called the One Club, which is one of the storied, legendary, it's our version of the Academy, you know, like when they talk about the Academy at the Oscars. So in advertising, the One Club is like the Academy for advertising. And I remember coming up, I wanted one of those pencils. I remember studying that the book, the One Club, One Show book, when I was in college at Michigan State, and said, "Damn, one of these days I'm gonna see my name off in there." And you know, that's one of the things that you guys should be shooting for and aiming for as well. So the One Club has gotten behind this strong now. We've been doing it for like 5 or 6 years or something like that. And it's really blossomed and really gotten big. And one of the dope things about it, and y'all are some bad mugs. I'm not talking about my black people right now. I'm talking about my other people who are not black. White, brown, yellow, everything, every hue under the sun. And we had some discussions like, why do you keep calling all the black people? Because people who aren't black aren't gonna show up. But you guys need to take selfies and show that, yes, indeed, other non-blacks will actually show up and participate. And so that's awesome and beautiful. We have one announcement that we want to make. I got two of my partners here, Ed Collins and John Gotthold over at Amusement Park. And John, why don't you come up here right quick? You guys might get off on this, might find this kind of exciting.
Well, good morning, everybody. So I'm not going to derail this agenda too much, but I thought you might like to know that that Ed and Jimmy and I talked about this, and we decided that what we're going to do as a result of this conference is we're looking to bring on at least two of you guys for a full paid internship in California. We'll fly you out there, we'll house you, we're going to get apartments for you. Unlike a lot of agencies who don't pay their interns, we actually pay them. Not a lot. And the other thing that we do is we'll actually have you do some work. A lot of times when you get an internship, you're just making coffee. I have some coffee. I like mine with cream. Jimmy likes his coffee actually just to be fresh pressed juice. So if you're one of the winners here, you know, remember that. Actually, I'm just kidding you. We don't do that. You'll actually get in. You'll get work. You'll get something for your portfolios. And so we just want to let you know that we're starting the California Gold Rush program. And so we're looking for at least two of you guys to come on out to LA and help make us famous.
And I don't know how many of you guys, that's one thing you should do in advertising is listen really intently. He said, at least. So that means that's up to you guys. You know, we'll take, nah, that's too many. We can't take 600, however many in the room. But you know what I mean. And another thing, a lot of our interns actually end up working at amusement park. So it's not just an internship to bring you on in and send you home. And again, you guys will determine that. Okay, enough of that. Let's get the show on the road. We got Tracy Smith, who is the bomb. And one of the main reasons all you folks are here, between Tracy and Kevin and Yash, but meet Miss Tracy.
How's everybody? I know a lot of you. How cool is Jimmy? Let's start with that. And what a great opportunity he and his business partners, John and Ed, they flew all the way in from California just to be here today. And we're very, very happy to have them here. They've got an incredible repertoire of work among them, so you should all be very eager and excited to get this opportunity, because a lot of the paid internships, you don't actually get to travel and you don't get housing paid for, so that's kind of cool. Welcome. And are you all ready for the day? I know a lot of you have traveled really far, so who's here from California? Sonia. Yeah, there she is. And who's here from Virginia? I want you guys to make some noise when we call you out. Maryland? DC? Where else are you from? Atlanta? I knew that was going to happen. I had somebody say they drove here from Birmingham, Alabama. Where are you? Where are you? There he is, all the way in the back. Hello. If I didn't call your city out, yell some cities out to me. Where are you from?
Detroit.
Oh, so my creative. Yay. And that means Mike's here with you somewhere. I don't see him. Where is he? Oh, well, he's somewhere. Hi, Mike. And any other cities? Did I miss anybody?
Austin.
Austin, we love you. GSDNM might have a job for you, Austin. So I just want to make sure that I thank all of our sponsors. We've got some really great agencies here today, and they're part of the reason that this gets to happen every year. And so please, let's hear it for our sponsors. They're all downstairs. You're going to meet with a lot of them, but they are terrific, and we really value them. They're our partners in this. And I also want to start out by thanking all of the creatives who are here to lend their time. You're going to meet a lot of great creatives from a lot of different agencies. Some of those creatives are sponsoring agencies, some of them aren't. So you'll meet everybody downstairs for portfolio reviews and recruiting, and you'll have a really good day. And I think, you know, many of you might end up with jobs when you leave here, which is the goal. In addition, I want to introduce someone who is just phenomenal. He is from Brooklyn, originally, Bed-Stuy. Who's here from Brooklyn? Yay, Brooklyn's in the house. You see, there's a lot larger Brooklyn representation. and Londell McMillan is a legend in the media sphere. He started out as an entertainment attorney. He then went on to purchase The Source. He is the owner and publisher of The Source magazine, one of the largest hip-hop magazines out there. He's really sort of changed and continues to change the face of this media industry and the representation of multiculturals in media. And he is a powerhouse and a force, and he's here today to speak with you about his career and about your career and your goals. So please give a really, really, really warm and loud welcome to Londell McMillan.
Thank you. Good morning. That was kind of whack. We can do better than that. Good morning.
Good morning.
That's what's up. That's what's up. Welcome to New York for all of those who are out of town. I heard the A is in the building heavy. Where's the A? I see a lot of folks there from Atlanta, but people from all over the United States. Welcome to New York. It's always a pleasure to see people come to this city. I'm a native New Yorker from Brooklyn. Grew up in housing projects that many of you have heard Jay-Z talk about in his records, Marcy houses and Tompkins houses, and went to school here in New York pretty much all of my life and career. And so it's always, I feel like a New York ambassador when people come to the city. So welcome again, and we look forward to this wonderful day. I want to thank the One Club. Let's give them a shout out and give them a big hand. Let them hear you. Kevin, Tracy, and Yoshi. And I also want to thank my friend Jimmy Smith and his colleagues and friends who had the boldness and the sense of vision to ask the question that many of us ask, but in an environment where sometimes people think that you should not ask for certain types of demands that are only right. But it's not only what you do, it's sometimes how you do it. And this was a great vision, and it's great to see it come to fruition. So let's give them all a great hand. Of course, the sponsors, we wouldn't be here without the advertising sponsors here who show by their commitment and their dedication and their deeds that the issue of multicultural inclusion and diversity is important. This is not new. This is something that we've been talking about for many, many years, and it comes up all the time, and it will be something that we will continue to advance for the rest of our lives. Let's get used to it. It's part of our rich tradition in America, and it's okay. But we want to thank those allies that are visionary and supportive of cultural inclusion and diversity, not only because it's a good thing to do, but it's also the rich thing to do. It's not only rich in culture, but it's rich in profits these days. And we'll talk a little bit about that. So let's give a loudest round of applause for all of the sponsors here today that you'll be meeting with. You know, as I thought about what I wanted to say to you, I just really wanted to just emphasize with an exclamation point that these are exciting times. Exciting times. It's exciting times in the world. It's exciting times here in our country, the United States. It's an exciting time in this industry of advertising, marketing, and media. It's truly a special time for people of color, because the world is changing at a very, very, very rapid rate. Technology is bringing so many people together at a very, very rapid rate. The notion of what they talk about with total market now, which is kind of the inclusion of all folks together, coming up with stories that matter, creative ideas, relationships and communication to people that matter, all people that matter, is something that is a very much at this time at the forefront of a discussion. It wasn't that way 10 years ago. Right now, it is very heavy. People are trying to figure out how to capture the total market enterprise. You don't do that just by spending money in all of the different media publications out there or the various different technology devices and sites and digital platforms and television and radio. You have to come up with ideas and stories. So it's an exciting time in terms of sharing your story, feeling great about your story. But there's a lot of work to do so that you can take your creativity and your story ideas and then find a way to integrate them into the business of advertising. So we'll talk about some of those tips later on, but I want to tell you a little bit about my story, just so you know a little bit about myself. I grew up in Brooklyn in Bed-Stuy. My mother was a beautician, and she did hair, obviously, and cosmetology, and she had her own beauty salon, and we lived in Brooklyn. She was from, actually, Georgia. My father was from North Carolina. So I was the first generation New Yorker, And then I went to high school in a school called Brooklyn Technical High School. So I thought I wanted to be a technical engineer. Then after getting involved in tech, I thought, well, I really like people more than tech. At least I thought I did. And so then I was also an athlete, so I played basketball and football, and I was able to go to Cornell University and join the School of Industrial Labor Relations, which ties into this whole job career fair where I was very active in the world of work and getting people to work, personnel, human resources, and getting people engaged in organizations that employ people to produce products or services. And so understanding that our number one investment is not the investment in only your idea, not just the investment in your product, but the investment in what? And people, right? Understanding that people power is very, very important. So investing in human capital and people who create ideas, because we'll create the story, we create the ideas. And so then I decided I wanted to go to law school. Somehow, you know, back in those days, almost every parent was like, my baby gonna go to law school, my baby gonna go be a doctor, a lawyer, you know, the careers were very limited, right? And you know, as the first generation going to college, that's, I always heard that in my head. So I didn't know exactly what I was gonna do, but I figured, let me just keep on going. I went on to law school. So then I ran across a gentleman who's now deceased, a legendary cat. His name was Reginald Lewis. Reginald Lewis was a lawyer who turned into an entrepreneur and became the first African-American man to acquire a billion-dollar company. It was called TLC Beatrice at the time. And I met him as I was the national chair of the National Law Students Association. And he said to me, he said, this was in 88. He said, young man, go into business, because business will be the civil rights of your generation. Now, I'm talking about my generation. There's another generation for you. But he said, go into business. That will be the civil rights of your generation. Now, why did he say that? Because he had asked me, what is it that you're going to law school for? And after studying the world of work and labor, you know, I really had a strong passion for doing the right thing. And I told him, I said, I want to be a civil rights lawyer. And he said, young man, go into business. And that hit me. But growing up in the arts and sports was still very much in my heart. It was just tugging at me. You know, I just loved music, I love sports, I love entertainment. I just couldn't get it away. So it was a passion for me. And I wanted to connect my passion to where I thought the opportunity existed and where I thought I could make a mark on society. So I started figuring out, how do I put those things together? And I say that because I'm going to come back to you later on and say, how do you put together where your passion lies and the opportunity exists? Then how do you research to find out what's the scope of those options so that you can connect those dots? Okay? You're already doing a great job because you're here, and some of those dots have been kind of aggregated for you with here are all the black people and the One Clubs initiative, but there's still more work to do. But again, just concluding my story, I then graduated, and then I went to one of the corporate law firms, and I started representing Time Warner and the Discovery Channel. I left there early, and at 30 years old, I decided I was going to build my own law firm. I wanted to focus on entertainment, artists, athletes, and be their legal advocate. I felt that in at that time, that athletes and entertainers, particularly growing up in the hip-hop generation, I felt that artists, they weren't getting their fair share of the piece of the pie. And I thought that they needed an advocate that could advocate on their behalf. So I said, you know, I'm going to leave the corporate firm now after I've developed my skills, learned. I said I was going to now use those skills to be an advocate for justice in my mind. But really, it was an entertainment industry. It was arts industry. It was the creative industry. I had passion in it. And I wanted to use my skill set in that area, which again is what I'm encouraging you to do. So I went and I started my own firm at 30 years old. And we grew the firm to become the largest black and brown firm, the African American, Hispanic, Latino firm in the city across entertainment in corporate life. And then I started acquiring businesses along the way with some of my partners. I started investing in shows and tours and going all around the country, getting into advertising, some real estate, just being interested and curious, which is what I'm encouraging everyone to do. Stay curious, stay thirsty to learn. Wanting to be creative, networking, having just a great personality with people, looking for positive people, being kind, all of the basic things that your parents, they teach you and you know exist. Once you get this education, you can't get arrogant with it. You now have to humble yourself and really go all in and show that you've got not just skills, but you've got that personality. And you're not fearless. And you can do it. And you can make it happen, right? And so just things started coming your way, and they're going to come your way because, again, you're at an amazing time right now, right? And things just started coming to me, just started coming, and I started sharing, and I started giving it back to people, and it started coming back more. And then I'm saying to you that if you just believe in yourself and take that risk in yourself, put that investment in yourself, it's all going to come to you. So I believe the biggest key for me was being prepared, staying inspired, and finding that passion and networking, right? Which is what I'm saying that I need you to do. That is my story. And what happened, the clients came thereafter. You know, first there were the artists that were painters and songwriters and producers, and then came the hip-hop artists that I loved, that were in my community, the sports, the athletes. Then came bigger artists, you know. Spike Lee came. Then came Prince. And once you get a big one, everybody comes, you know. Then I started getting my mom's favorite artists, like Aretha Franklin and Roberta Flack. Can I get a hand clap for Aretha Franklin and Roberta Flack? You don't know culture. You gotta know that story. R-E-S-P-E-C-T. What it means to me. I can't sing, but I got passionate about it.
And this is a woman, she's speaking about respect, but it speaks to me. When she says respect, she's talking about me. That's what I tell my girlfriend. R-E-S-P-E-C-T, baby. You know, but then they start to come. Things start to happen. People start to come into your life. Going back to kindness and how you treat people and being positive, they start to feel your light. You want to let your light shine. Your light can't shine if you don't believe in yourself. You're going to go have all of these interviews. I'm telling you, and I don't even know you, you all are amazing. You've got to let your light shine. You got to believe that. And if you don't believe it on a 100, take that 10% you believe it and believe that 10% 100. And just focus on that and be a great 10. You're going to have an opportunity today. You're going to have an opportunity today. And you're gonna meet with people, and they're going to meet with you, and they're going to see it, and you're going to say what? You're going to say, I want you to call me on my cell phone whenever I leave this interview. Call me on my cell phone. You're going to make your hotline bling with them. You're going to give them all your info. And they're coming back to you. You got to make things simple. Don't make it too sophisticated. Even though there's a level of sophistication you have to appreciate that's part of the learning experience, but then you reduce it down to very simple science. Many of you may be looking at creative positions. Now, I don't have the expertise to tell you what it is to be a great creative. Yeah, I talked to Jimmy for that. But what I can tell you, for me, everything creative starts with my meditation and a pen and a piece of paper, or a pencil and a piece of paper. Then I start thinking what screen I'm going to apply it to, or what platform, or how I'm going to build it out. You know, you have to talk to mentors that are in that space. I'm not qualified for that, okay? But what I can say, whatever it is that you do, wherever you feel short, find friends and others in a team to balance you out, right? But today, it's one-on-one. It's you with that person, one of those good folks that are part of the advertising team that came here. They didn't have to come here, by the way. They could have bailed out. Their organizations could have bailed out. You know, they could be here based on, I'm going to keep it 100 with you right now. They could be here because they have 100% commitment, or they could be here because they got a 75% commitment. But they're here. You can turn a 75% committed person to a 100% fan today. And if not today, later. But get the experience, and you'll grow. So I kind of went through a number of my tips in the course of the discussion, but I did the research for some of you. I went online because, again, I'm not the most qualified to tell you what's best to do today alone. I could just tell you what's best to be great with what you have. And it starts with believing in yourself, being prepared, and going for it. But I did the research because whether you are in advertising, whether you're in law, whether you're in research and development for any business organization, research is key. You need research. You need data. That's so much what's driving the whole digital platforms that we see now, how data is collected. One thing, though, about data is, in many cases, it can tell you a lot, but it can't tell you what's next and why with the same proficiency that it can tell you what happened. That comes, again, with experiences and relationships. This is why you're so important, because we're representing a multi-trillion dollar economy. You've got to understand that. The black and browns that we see represent cultural communities that represent a multi-trillion dollar economy. And we're all part of the rich tapestry of America, and we're all global citizens. You matter. You're not on the fringes anymore. Embrace it. Feel great about it. That's not going to replace being prepared. So again, just going through these points, and then I'm going to open up for a few questions, and then I'm going to close. Where's your passion? You got to ask yourself. That some of it just pops right out. To others, it's not quite clear. You're kind of on the fence. You know, where's your passion? And I want to tie something else to that to make you really great. When you can tie your passion to your purpose, when you find your purpose, that's amazing. You may not have your purpose right now, and that's okay. But what are you passionate about? And then what do you excel in? What do you really do really well in? Do they connect? Can you connect them? You know, you may have a passion that you just are not really that great in, and you may need the second passion point. You may want to list your top three or four passion points and try to see what you excel in. Don't give up on your greatest passion, but just understand where it fits in what we call the waterfall of things. Okay, because you want your career to flow. You're at a stage now where it's time to rock and roll. You know, the show, it's showtime. Today is showtime. We're not middle school. It's showtime. So where do you excel, and can you align your passion and your purpose together? Research the employers and know about their companies. Make sure that they don't feel that they're there as an obligatory duty, but they're there because whomever they're talking to took the time to know something about what they do, what their company is about. You all can do that on your cell phone. Just go right on your search engine if you haven't done it. I know most of you have already done this. I mean, really? And you're like, really, right? Really? No, really. It's like four or five of you that didn't do it yet. So please make sure you get that done. Find your mentors and your advisors, obviously. Find them. Even if it's on social media. Even if they're not a direct person speaking to you. You can follow many people. You can follow Tracy, you can follow Kevin, you can follow Jimmy, you can follow me at Londell McMillan on Twitter. You can follow me there. You can follow whomever you want, but just find mentors. You really, you know, when one-on-one is better, but make sure that you have those mentors, advisors, and coaches in your life. I would also suggest that you seek to publish and write things. Even if you know, so many websites out here that need content, take your time to write it out so that you can have something. You can send people links. You can send folks links. That's impressive. Oh, you got a link. On what site? I don't know. As long as it's a dignified site, so when they go on it, it looks presentable. But it at least evidences you've thought about something to put pen to paper, right? It shows that you care. It shows that you've taken another step. It shows that you don't think the world owes you something. Have to produce. So their attention span is often short. So if you can show that, yeah, I'm cutting through the clutter. Don't judge me because of anything you see. You listen to me. I can help you with this idea. I've got something that's going to solve that problem. I've got something that the client is going to actually enjoy. I've got a story to tell that's going to match where the client is going to go. You have to hear this. You have to see it. Believe in it. Put together a whole bunch of storyboards. Practice storyboards. Make them up. Make up a scenario. Put in that hard work. Just know you can do it. Be cleverly bold. With a good spirit, like Jimmy Smith did with this idea. Be cleverly bold with a good spirit. It's going to benefit you. More specific, we've got to eat and breathe digital now. We've got to understand it. But still don't forget the basics offline. You're going to be strong. It's going to happen. If you don't get knocked down, you just have to think that it's coming some point. And I will tell you, just as representing talent for so many years. Those artists that I've represented that didn't have it tough early on getting to where they are at the peak of their career, when they do get knocked down or when they put out their first project and it doesn't hit. Like Shonda Rhimes been around for a long time. You know, Jay-Z, long before he got a hit record, he was failure. He couldn't even get on. He had to do it independently. You know, where there were other artists, like I represent a guy named D'Angelo. He got a deal right off the top. Boom, straight to the top. And then when it hits, the recovery is so much more difficult. The bump is coming. It comes for all of us. It comes for every agency here. They've lost clients. They will lose clients. They don't like losing clients. They won't want to lose clients. So all of these things happen, right? So just keep in mind that the bumps are going to come. And so you got to be ready for those bumps, but persevere. And one of the last things I want to say is an amazing woman in this industry, Sheryl Sandberg. She wrote a book called Lean In. And in that book, she talked about there's no longer a traditional career path. There's so many different ways to get to the top. I want you all to realize that your career may wind and road, be a winding road, but just get in, lean in, and move forward. And don't forget, you all are amazing. So with that said, I'd like you all to have an opportunity to ask any questions if you have any questions, and if not, I want to give you all a great hand and feel the energy because you guys are going to do just terrific today. The microphones are here or there, or you can stand up and ask a question. And if no one's in the mood to ask a question, there's going to be a great panel. You all are here from experts who are far more knowledgeable in the specific areas of creative and advertising than I, and you're going to have a wonderful day. Any questions? Jimmy.
I got a question.
Yes, sir.
So what was your bump, and how did you do what you do to overcome
it? I had numerous bumps, Jimmy. You can call me Bumpy Londell. You know, I think my first major bump was the SAT. You know, when you're told you're smart over and over and over and over, and then that SAT comes and you go, boop. Then it was the LSAT. Then I think, for me, on a very, very personal note, I lost my mother at an early age. That was a major bump. Yeah. At 24 years old, right? You do all this work. You say you make your mom proud. You're doing it. And then, boom, some of you may be able to relate to that, maybe. But that was a major bump. You know, when you lose your first big client, I used to always say, I'm never going to lose a client. When you lose your first big client, it's another major bump. I just recently had one of the biggest bumps of my career. It's kind of like you have to reset, and you can go online and research this. I was the global media head of one of the largest law firms in the world. After I left the firm filed for chapter bankruptcy, largest in United States history, after a number of us had left the firm for various reasons. And all of the creditors come after the partners. So that's a new bump. Bumps are continuous. Just got to get ahead of it. And it's going to come, you know, it's going to come. So I've had so many bumps that I've just grown accustomed to it. But it makes you stronger. Any other questions? Y'all scared? Well, anyway, with that, okay, I see one or two. I see one or two. I see the ladies first.
Hi, I was wondering, what is probably the most important advice that you got?
The most important advice that I've gotten is to be prepared and be kind. Simple. And I use it in every area of my life, you know, from what I'm trying to do with both. I don't just own The Source. I own Jones Magazine, which is a multicultural women's fashion and beauty magazine, and The Source. If you look at that cover, for example, that speaks to the type of way I've kind of redirected The Source, where we're very edgy and hardcore, but we still are socially responsible and progressive with what we do. I'm prepared for the arguments that are going to come my way about how and what hip-hop can do and can mean. I'm prepared for all of that. I've lived that life, right? I'm about that life. I'm for really about that life. But at the same time, I know the potential of what this culture means, not just to the total market, but to the world and to our young people. And I'm prepared to make a change. And I need you all to make a change. And by the way, y'all all can reach me too, because we do have internships as well with what we do. But it's very important just to be prepared and to be kind. Just to be kind. Even sometimes it's hard to be kind in certain situations, but you just, that's the best advice I've gotten.
How you doing?
Good, thank you.
When Reginald Lewis told you that getting into business will be the civil rights of your generation, do you believe that now that you are in business and some of your media properties you own?
Absolutely. I believe that now, but I believe it's now become more refined in terms of specifically the types of business. And I think it's using creativity and technology to advance culture. I think using creativity and technology to advance culture. Because when you can do that at the intersection of commerce, you're going to show value. Okay, walk with me on that. Creativity and technology to advance culture, to connect to people. When you connect to people in the intersection of commerce, you will show value. Today's free market economy cannot afford to walk away from value that allows them to excel, because things are moving so fast, things are so competitive. And those leaders who walk away from value, or those leaders that leave value on the table because of their own prejudices or whatever they may have, their own preferences, they may not even know it's prejudices, it could be preferences, but they're not looking to reach out beyond their own comfort zones and find value, those leaders will not last long. And so I'm saying you have to believe in your ability to bring value, and I couldn't believe it more now than ever, but I think that the tools of the trade for the business are much different. At the time, he was talking more like M&A, mergers and acquisitions, corporate finance, and those things are very, very important on a very macro level. But specifically for this audience, I believe your creativity and your ability to make sure that it gets integrated into the technology tools and things that is very, very, very important, because everything starts with a great idea. Everything starts with a great idea, and I combine it that way with, and it's regulated and controlled by the rule of law. Thank you so much, everyone. Have a great day, and don't forget, you are amazing. Hotline Bling. Don't forget Hotline Bling.
Can we please give it up, please? One more, right?
You may even have to come with me to all of them. Thank you so much.
Wow. You know, it's funny. Until you get... wow, they're going to move that. Let me get out of the way. Until you get someone like Londell... You know, you realize that you're never too old or young to learn, right? And I think he just espoused so much wisdom And I hope we all sort of digested all that he had to say. He's just a brilliant person, and we're very fortunate to have had him come in and join us this morning. He actually spoke last night, so you would never know that he's probably exhausted, but he was phenomenal. We have something really great, another really great panel, and you guys can shake yourselves off, and this is gonna be really stellar. We have some of the best creatives in the industry, aside from Jimmy and his team, who are gonna speak later. But we have a great panel coming up to talk about one of the things that we're noticing in advertising, which is brands who are trying to do good in their messaging. They're trying to really kind of talk about socially conscious issues and things in their advertising. And so this panel is amazing. So I want you guys to really, really, really dig in and listen to what they have to say, because we couldn't be more blessed to have them here today. I'm gonna start out by introducing the contributing editor. She's really, really bright. Ms. Barbara Lippert, and thank you, if we could hear it for Barbara. And she's gonna come out with the other panelists.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And I'm a panel of one, thank you. I guess something needs to be said that here are the white people, but anyway. Wow, that guy really ripped the lid off the joint. Boy, was he fantastic. I really, really admire what he said, and I agree with every single thing. So most of today will be sort of inspiration like that and practical help in terms of getting a job and what you should be doing. What we're offering here is a bit on the other spectrum. It's showing that once you do start working, if you're very, very lucky, you get to work on stuff that really affects humanity. It's wonderful to sell a product, but this stuff is really helping people, and it sort of will give you goosebumps to be allowed to do it, because it's so. Today we've picked the best of the best of the recent stuff we call either advocacy advertising or cause marketing or advertising to good. I'm sure there'll be a new name for it in 5 minutes. Whatever it is, it's really the best that the industry produces. I'm going to introduce each person on the panel, and then we're going to show their particular video. And after all the videos are completed and their knockout stuff, then we'll talk among the panel, and then we'll ask questions. So I hope you enjoy all the stuff that awaits. So we're going to start with Icaro. Right. And he serves as Chief Creative Officer of DDB New York. Before DDB, he was the founder and executive creative director of Wieden & Kennedy in Sao Paulo, Brazil, where he says he took it from a kitchen table to an office of 160 people. That's something. And his career has also spanned 3 continents, which you'll find a lot. A lot of people go all over the world in terms of their careers, Brazil to Portugal to the US. And he was at Wieden & Kennedy, Brazil, for a long time. So we're going to show his film first, his agency's film, which is a topic that is so meaningful. I just heard that one of the Genius Awards went to a person who's doing drinkable water, the same thing. It's called Drinkable Water, for Water is Life. Let's see that video.
3.4 million people die each year from water-related disease. But the even bigger problem, most of them don't even know their water is unsafe to drink in the first place. That's why Water is Life, partnering with scientists and engineers at Carnegie Mellon and the University of Virginia, set out to invent a solution that solves both of these problems. Introducing the Drinkable Book, the first ever tool that teaches safe water habits and is printed on technologically advanced filter paper capable of killing deadly waterborne diseases.
My name is Terry Dinkvich. I am a chemist. I invented a paper that purifies drinking water. After passing water through our filter, we found a reduction of greater than 99.9% in bacteria count, which is comparable to the tap water in this country.
The book uses a brand new type of paper that works like a scientific coffee filter. Each piece is coated with silver nanoparticles, which kill diseases like cholera, E. coli, and typhoid.
The orange color of the paper is a direct result of the addition of the silver nanoparticles. And at the end of the day, the most important thing, and really the hero of this whole project, is the technology behind it.
The book itself works in three easy steps. Simply tear out a filter, slide it into the custom filter box, and pour contaminated water through. What comes out is safe to drink. The content on each page, printed in food-grade ink, educates people about safe water habits, things that we take for granted, such as keeping trash and feces away from your water source. But the best part of the book isn't just that it purifies water or teaches proper sanitation, it's the fact that this filter paper, it costs only pennies to produce, making it by far the cheapest option on the market, and it's extremely sustainable. Each filter is capable of giving someone up to 30 days worth of clean water, and each book is capable of providing someone with clean water for up to 4 years. To learn how you can provide a filter book for a community in need, head to wateris.life.com.
Each book up to 4 years of water. That is just amazing. Okay, next on the panel is Andreas Dahlqvist, one of the famous Swedes in the business. He oversees the agency's Gray's creative department. He's the chief creative officer, and he previously served as president of the McCann Global Creative Leadership Council and CCO at Commonwealth McCann, and as vice chairman, executive creative director, and later deputy chief creative officer for global brands at McCann New York. He founded DDB in Sweden and the Nordics in 2004. And the video we're going to be showing from Gray, New York, is The Gun Shop.
A gun shop popped up on the Lower East Side last week.
Gun shop in Manhattan, but it's not what you might think.
Gun shop.
Gun shop.
Gun shop.
The gun shop opened in New York for 2 days with the goal of making first-time gun buyers think twice.
The store was set up here last week in a matter of hours, outfitted with cameras.
And they were taping while it all happened. And here is some of what they got. Watch this.
It's our most popular one. It's this 22 caliber 6-inch revolver. It's also a gun that a 5-year-old found in his parents' bedroom, went down and shot his 9-month-old baby brother with it.
When it says shooter, 5-year-old kid, dead one, what does that mean?
That's the history.
This is the gun that the guy shot.
That's the gun.
This is the one? This is the one that the kid used? Holy shit.
Sie hat die Aktion ganz bewusst
inspiriert. Something like this aims to change not laws, but individual minds about the wisdom of buying guns. Maybe they can't. The NRA seems pretty worried that they might.
They all should get genius awards. Okay, next is Will Chow from GSD&M. He's the creative director at GSD&M in Austin, Texas. And in his spare time, he also is a founder instructor of the Austin Creative Department, which is an ad school that he started as an alternative to very expensive higher education. And he's taught and mentored hundreds of diverse students, some with full scholarships, who have ended up with fantastic jobs in the industry. So he's a guy you should speak to. And Will is agency to get a shot, give for Walgreens.
If I grow up, I will help others which they don't know. If I grow, I want to be an accountant. If I be a big one, I like to be a teacher.
In low-resource countries right now, vaccine-preventable diseases account for about 20% of all childhood deaths.
In 2013, Walgreens set out to create a simple solution to help solve a global problem. We called it Get a Shot, Give a Shot.
It's a collaboration between the UN Foundation and the Walgreens Company, in which for every vaccine that we administer at our pharmacies, then Walgreens will donate a vaccine in an underdeveloped country.
Partnering with the UN Foundation Shot at Life program, we took something routine in our customers' lives, their annual flu shot, and made it a way for them to save lives. We spread the word about Get a Shot, Give a Shot through digital, television, and a unique social and outdoor integration to encourage and empower our customers to spread the word themselves. We even traveled to Tanzania to inspire them by showing the full impact their flu shot can make.
Programs like Get a Shot, Give a Shot, it brings life to this country. It brings chances to live.
In our custom social and outdoor platform, customers could pledge to give a child a shot at life. And when they became part of the movement, their profile picture became part of mosaic outdoor boards in Denver and Times Square, boards that dynamically grew as the movement grew. The program dramatically spiked flu shot sales, but ultimately, only one number truly matters. Our customers helped provide over 3 million life-saving vaccines.
When we're vaccinating a child, you're providing an opportunity. So it's not an if I will grow up, it's an I will grow up.
When I grow up, I want to be a lawyer.
When I grow up, I like to be an accountant or a singer.
When I grow up, I want to be a doctor.
Wow, these are killers. Okay, next is Greg Hahn, who is the Chief Creative Officer of BBDO. New York, and he joined BBDO as an ECD in 2005. He was a writer and executive creative director on HBO Voyeur, which, along with winning multiple Grand Prix Lions at Cannes, was selected by the One Club as one of their best of the digital decade. And before joining BBDO, Greg was at Fallon Minneapolis, where he worked on the Emmy-nominated Cat Herders for EDS and the BMW film series, both of which are historically important in advertising, and you guys should look those two things up because they're worth watching. Now, Greg, the work from BBDO is Monsters Under the Bed.
Could you tell me about some of those drawings that you have? What's that one?
This one?
Yeah, that one. Yeah, what is it? Can you show it to me?
It's a monster. It's a swamp monster.
That's a swamp monster?
A demon bird. It's a monster with a lot of spikes. And it was all gray with very long fingernails. It's a witch with her cape and sharks.
Uh-huh.
Goblins. Zombies, because they eat people's brains.
A snake sword with a snake head on the top.
Her eyes roll up, and then she has fangs.
What do the fangs look like? What do you do to fight bad dreams?
Well, we have a couple methods.
Sonia has a little buddy that she sleeps with that helps keep her safe.
We just place our foreheads together. We go like this, and he counts to 10. And baddies have this power.
It's usually in reading.
Check under the bed, check in the closet.
He has this little blankie.
But he doesn't want anyone to know. And he potion in a spray bottle, and you spray, and he disappears.
We shut the closet door before bed.
No more monsters.
How do you protect him from gun violence?
For gun violence.
I mean, I just, it's, I don't even.
That's a really good question.
I don't really think about it as much as maybe I should.
Nobody expects it in their school. Nobody expects it in their town.
I wish I had a magic wand to change everything in the world that's wrong.
Should I not let them go to school, and should I keep them home and just teach them at home so we can avoid this? But then my husband's saying, well, you can't let the kids live in a bubble.
You really want to make everything right once you have a kid.
Okay, well, this next one actually has a very different tone, and we'd probably say it's NSFW. So if anybody has very delicate sensibilities, you should probably leave. But it comes from Droga 5, New York. And we have two people on the panel from Droga 5, Sarah Shelton, who's a senior copywriter. She began her career as the original writer for then startup Johannes Leonardo Lab, and she spent a lot of freelance years for various great agencies, ended up in Costa Rica, where she worked from there remotely and wrote for a Costa Rican surf blog. And she's back here, you know, working and planning her life. And so she's been a writer at Droga 5 since 2013. Ted is the chief creative officer of Droga 5. He would like you to know that he's originally from Philadelphia. And he graduated from the Portfolio Center in 1995. And he's listed hundreds of awards, which we don't have time to go through, but as the youngest person ever to be at Wieden & Kennedy, his Sports Center ads became part of a class taught at Harvard about successful business entrepreneurs. And he really got a kick out of that because he said he could never have gotten into Harvard himself. But his work is being taught there. Okay, so this is Sarah Silverman with all of her Sarah Silverman humor. And let's see it.
Oh, hi, I'm Sarah Silverman, writer, comedian, and vagina owner. Women make up almost half the working population, yet we typically earn just 78 cents to every dollar a man makes in almost every profession, like doctors, lawyers, teachers, miners, and even the oldest profession of them all, tailors. Every year, the average woman loses around $11,000 to the wage gap. Over the course of the working years of her life, that's almost 500 grand. That's a $500,000 vagina tax. That's why I'm taking matters into my own hands. Somebody else's hands, really. Dr. Goldstein. Or is it Goldstein?
O'Malley.
I'm becoming a dude. In the grand scheme of things, it's way less expensive than the money I'll... Plus, I'll finally be able to pee on walls. Or, it will be easier to pee on walls. Whoa. So many. Do you have anything a little more, European? I just feel like as a woman, I'm extremely sensitive. Oh. And I expect no less from my dick. Oh my God, I have boots that would look amazing with this. I'll take it.
All right. Actually, we're all out of stock on that one. You can have the display model if you want.
Oh, okay.
I guess I was kind of hoping for that new penis smell.
Oh, yeah. No, none of them have that. It's kind of more like sourdough bread.
I realize this may be an extreme solution for some women. That's why we're trying to raise the trillions of dollars the rest of you ladies will be cheated out of over the course of your careers. If we hit our goal, every woman in America will get a check for the amount they're owed. If not, we'll donate the money to the National Women's Law Center. I know, it sounds like an old lady's gym, but really, they fight to get women the money they deserve, from pushing legislation like the Paycheck Fairness Act, to promoting flexible work hours, to keeping employers accountable for legislation that is already in place. They're very good at what they do, you know, for a bunch of girls. So come on, together we can fill the gap. We may not be able to pay every woman back, but at least there will be one less of us to worry about, this guy. Hey, could you give me 2 really big balls? Like, I feel like I'm gonna be a ball man.
Huh?
Or make it 3. It's gonna take a lot of balls to tell women that the wage gap is fair.
Oh, right.
Wait, let me say goodbye to my breasts.
Isles, Rizzoli.
It's been a wild ride. I'm gonna miss you 2 knuckleheads. Okay.
Yeah?
I'm ready. Does this penis make me look fat?
Sarah.
And he told me how he was really bummed.
Okay, I'm just wiping a little tear from my eye. Well, since that was the last one, let's start with a question for the Droga 5 crew. Have you been able to, I mean, I know that you can measure it with, you know, how viral it is and how much it was shared, but any kind of results of how much money the Law Center got or what's happened since?
In the first 3 days, $100,000 was raised for the National Women's Law Center.
Oh, wow.
It's pretty exciting. We didn't raise the $30 trillion for wage gap.
Yeah, well, $100,000 will keep them working for a while. So maybe we should just go along the panel and we can talk a little bit about the results of each of them and then talk about how they came about and the problems in making them and how long it took and social media and all that. Greg?
For results, the main goal of the campaign was really just to get the conversation started and to get people thinking about the issue differently, so it's hard to measure that. As far as money goes, to the Sandy Hook Foundation, there was 250,000 donated within the first 2 weeks. So even though that wasn't the primary goal, it exceeded anything we thought we would ever.
Right, and these are all online.
Yeah.
Okay. And Will?
The video we saw actually was done after the first year. So that was 3 million. The program's been going on for 3 years now, and it's up to 7 million shots now.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so it's pretty impressive.
Yeah, really does make a difference.
Actually, I want to give credit to the creators of the project. It was Nicole Davis, Barry Brothers, Victor Camozzi, and Brian Edwards. So those guys really did a great job on this.
Andreas?
Yeah. I mean, I think the issue going after
keep it credible for things. There are some products out there who seem to tack causes on as a bid to get attention and a bid to use people's good nature. But I think it is pretty important to not cross a line and seem crass with that or seem like you're just being opportunistic. And which none of these pieces are, by the way. I think this is brilliant work, but you're right. When we get into brands, we like to really say, is this credible coming from a cookie or from a tire, you know, or something like that, where, if you're talking about a subject completely unrelated and having no relation to it, it does come across as opportunistic. But it's our job as creatives to police that and to keep
our clients
honest.
I remember like when Droga 5 did the TAP project that you can take us through the whole idea. What to me was like such mind-opening ideas as someone who works in advertising was that it approached the problem with a, like, you know, kind of like with a creative business approach versus just coming up with a few ads and a few like print ads and a couple TV ads. It was actually like something that would invite people in New York to indulge themselves by going out to dinner. And with that, like in a very practical way, contribute with UNESCO, right?
The UN.
The UN. So I remember like when I saw this, it was like such an like eye-opening approach to solving a real problem. And I think a lot of agencies took inspiration from that and kind of started like presenting ideas like that to clients. And clients noticed something like that. And it's like, oh, we should associate ourselves with actually having to stand for something that's more than just like, you know, pushing out detergent and whatnot.
So right, right. Greg, did...
I mirror what Ted was saying, is that it has to line up with the company. Otherwise, it feels like you're just trying to take advantage of someone's problem and other people's goodwill. So, you know, we always try to make sure that what they're supporting lines up with the vision of the company, so it doesn't feel like a mismatch. And also, it's a different situation when you're doing work for a charity, specifically not through a company, because obviously that work is going to be the purest because you understand why they're doing it. And so, you know.
Right, so that gets into more of a PSA territory.
Yeah, and that's something that a lot of agencies do, which I think gives creatives a lot of opportunity to express, you know, some talents that they wouldn't be able to with certain other clients. And also, like, you'll find if you have those projects in the agency, so it gives, you know, it's win for everybody.
Yeah, it's a nice thing, and all juniors can work on it, everybody can work on it and feel like they've contributed.
Yeah, it's just something that it brings out a different side of your brain, and it brings out, it's really motivating to a creative to know that what you're doing actually has an impact on the world and can change, you know, make some great change for people who don't have that voice.
Yeah.
I will add, as someone who works on briefs at the agency, it's amazing when I start working on a new client how when you really throw yourself in and start doing research about that category, how common it is that you find something that you do become passionate about that needs a change. Like, we were pitching a food company and it was a lighthearted tone, but then when we really got into researching it, we learned all about how much food we're wasting in the world, and it just, the conversation sort of turned towards that and got my partner and I really excited. So it's common and it is genuine.
I think that's an interesting point. You can take what the client does and dig deep and find the cause that is really relevant to them instead of saying, here's the cause du jour and here's
right,
the client.
Right, right.
Yeah.
And Andreas?
But I think that's the kind of where it's going in a way, right? Like, it's part of what we're talking about, right, is doing social good.
Yes.
But I think the bigger kind of, this is almost just preempting a bigger shift that's going to happen in the market, or it's already happening in general, where you put that big brand purpose, whatever that is, and that could be something that's very practical. Doesn't need to be to do good in the world from a social perspective. It could be extending the marketing into a space where it actually becomes a utility, or it's an action, or it changes something. And I think the biggest shift for me when I look at stuff is, yes, you need to ask yourself, is this right for the brand, that there needs to be a lineup? But I think the bigger shift is this right for people, you know? Is this right? The stuff we're creating, will this resonate with people and be useful for people?
Right.
I think that's kind of a bigger shift that's coming from. It's starting to kind of really be visible in this space, but it's also moving over to a space where it becomes more commercial, you know, without necessarily a social cause. It could be, you know, something where we extend the brand purpose for any brand into doing stuff that just sits outside of, you know, programming a message and broadcasting.
Yeah, but that's where it starts to cut, you know, on the line of opportunism and...
Right, but it depends on what you do. So if you can look at any brand and look at what's the core purpose of it, it doesn't need to go into a place where it saves the world, but it could be something, how can I
help
what this product is kind of put into the world to do, extend that thought into the marketing and, you know, actually help, you know, the people that are consuming it somehow.
And it also makes the message, you know, nicer, I mean, more interesting to hear than the same old, Will, did you want to?
Yeah, I agree with what you guys are saying. I think the real exciting thing, what gets me excited about the future is that I think a lot of big global companies, you know, they're trying to do good, but it's got to come out, like what you guys are saying, it's got to come out of the DNA of the brand, you know, for it to have the legitimacy. I think the new model is that, you know, in the past, a lot of big brands would say, okay, we need to do our part for the world and let's write our check, give it to a philanthropic organization. Well, now, you know, they're realizing that, you know, the crossroads of doing good, but also making a big profit, you know, that's kind of the sweet spot. And, you know, it's not just brands like Tom's and these small startups, but right. It's big global brands. I mean, I just read that the largest energy supplier in Italy last year, 38 or 40% of the energy that was harnessed was from wind energy, clean energy. And they made a $4 billion profit.
It's like a biggest change you can see is that, you know, Walmart sells now brands that actually stand for very clear topics. And Walmart's not just, you know, the good guy who sell good right. products. They're only selling because people demand to buy those brands. And I think that just shows how people want to buy brands that...
We did a campaign for Honeymade graham crackers around the word wholesome. And we featured a gay couple who had been married, and they were one of examples of our wholesome families, along with a guy who was super tattooed up, and he's wholesome even though he has this punk rock thing. But we debated for a little bit whether or not that was credible for Honeymade to go into it. But we looked at 100 years of Honeymade advertising, and the one word they stuck with the entire time was wholesome. So we felt that we had a right to comment on what wholesome actually means and what wholesome families stand for. Every single Honeymade ad for the last 100 years talked about wholesome families. So we felt, you know what, it's just natural right now to come down on the side of what we feel are wholesome families. And it was a very, you know, huge national conversation, still is. But I was very happy to have a brand weigh in on what we really thought was the side of right and have a pretty big impact because of it. We received a ton of hate from groups like the Million Moms, who are actually only about 70,000 moms. but you know, fine, we knew that was gonna happen, we anticipated it, and we even did response videos after it. Again, I think it's great to be able to use your muscles to help steer a brand into a territory that it should be, where it can actually make a difference.
Right, one of the responses to the hate was a wonderful video where you took...
All the hateful comments and we made a sculpture out of them that said the word love. And then we took all the good comments and put it around the sculpture and made it this huge thing. And that got a ton of press. You know, in this world today that's full of so many people throwing hateful comments around, it was nice to anticipate it and turn it into something beautiful in a timely way.
Yeah, and I think that's probably a great way to end. Do we have time for questions? A couple of questions. Yeah, so yeah, turning it around. And also what the guy, you know, the previous speaker was saying about taking bumps and expecting them and being prepared for them and turning them around. That's so important in the work. Okay, you'll have to walk up to the microphone if anyone has a question for the panel.
You know, it's also using, you know, a first as a means to kind of generate some major conversation and attention around it. I still think there's a lot of mileage that we can, you know, squeeze out of this idea. And to be honest, it's more about kind of actually having the resources to do it. But I would also say that, you know, it's a little bit about getting something that is a little bit of, has that value of, wow, I can't believe that they did that. And that's also why it gets picked up in all the news media that covered it and why it got passed around in social media, as it were. So I think that's also part of the answer. I think we need to keep coming up with stuff of kind of surprising and, you know, attacking a subject differently, because I think that's the biggest effort that we've been doing over the last couple of years around this subject, to kind of figure out new ways of changing the conversation around the topic that's, you know, very polarizing.
Very quickly, because we want to get to that.
I think Gray did an idea before that, which I thought, I mean, the gun store is great, but the one before that, I don't know if you guys saw it, where you could actually change your 401k and get rid of gun stocks. Is that right?
That's right.
I thought that was a blistering idea. And to you young creators out there, that's an amazing example of an idea that we don't ever have to go backwards from. If there's a mechanism out there now that can allow you to change your 401k, moving forward, we should be able to do that with everything in our 401k and be able to vote with literally our investment dollars. That's an idea I think that was one of the biggest, scariest ideas I've ever seen. It could really change things going forward. That's the kind of idea I think you should be shooting for.
And I think
Please.
Thanks. But I think it's also comes back to the notion of, you know, trying to figure out ways to really move the business, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Whether that's for a cause or for a business that we're working for as, you know, more of a brand or a client, regular client. I think that's the notion of figuring out ways of kind of really making a shift happen, not just programming that message. And
getting that's advertising, those sorts of strategies.
100%.
Yes, at the microphone.
Hi. This is about the Sarah Silverman spot. And so I read a lot of press about this as well. And I know we're here to promote like inclusive environments and like bumps in the road get in the way. So how did your agency respond to the criticism about the spot being a bit offensive to transgender people?
That's a good question. So what happened was there was a vocal group, transgender element that took offense to the video. And our client, the law center, was full of very, you know, positive-minded, very sensitive people who are very sensitive to these issues. So it did cut momentum. They didn't want to offend anybody. They had one issue that they were really trying to promote. It was very interesting and a little sad to see one interest group trying to do one thing and another interest group with a different agenda, maybe undercutting it, when I'm sure those people were incredibly like-minded across the board and very sympathetic to each other's issues. So I guess the point is, when you come up with your ideas, you have to know that we're in a world that is full of people who have issues and possibly might choose to be outraged by the thing that you think is quite positive. It's a very, very sensitive world. So this is, you know, the honeymaid thing is a great example. You have to prepare your clients for a certain element will give backlash to any idea with oomph to it, with creative oomph to it.
Right.
It's a great point.
I wanted to ask, did Sarah Silverman create that, write it herself?
What we did, and we did this with a great celeb too, we gave her talking points and we told her the entire story. We told her what we were doing with our structure and all the details and let her write
and
a bunch of
it. She came up with turning herself into a dude.
You don't, I think so.
Yeah. Okay,
But you don't hire Sarah Silverman and not let
Exactly. yes.
Hi, I'm Simone Pratt. I work at Global Hue. And I just had a question about how are you all finding your brands adding a component of for purpose into their strategy? I mean, most of our brands are for profit, but in terms of like the Walmart, I mean, the Walgreen model of buy one, give one, are you finding that some of your clients are also adding some of that philanthropy component into their total business strategy?
Yeah, at BBDO, I've seen that in briefs more and more. It's almost become part of every brand's, you know, there's a portion of almost every brand that's like, what can we do with our messaging and or our resources to help common good? And I think, you know, they're not just doing it because they're altruistic. They're also doing it because it's good for business. People stand behind it, and they see that, like the Walmart or the Walgreens thing. I'm sure people went to them versus the competitor because they are, you know, giving part of themselves to something bigger than, you know, getting a shot. So I'm sure that affected the bottom line in a good way. So they're not stupid. They're going to see that this is an opportunity, and as long as everything lines up and there's no reason not to do it.
I want to have people for you and people against you. And the first thing you need to like align with your clients is that they're like the moment you stand for something, there's going to be a lot of people coming at you, and you just need to feel comfortable with, you know, sticking to your guts. I think that's like a, especially with social media, like anyone can have a voice and say that you're a piece of shit, and you need to deal with that with, you know, and have your foot in the ground and not react to it with anger. Everyone's entitled to have an opinion. You don't have to agree with everyone as much as they don't have to agree with you.
And Sarah, what were you gonna say before then?
Oh, that was like a minute ago. that it does happen where the clients come in and say that they wanna do something, but then there's also this other opportunity where you still get the briefs for a 30-second spot or banners or whatever the standard stuff is, but then you can go to a client with an idea and say, you should find the money for this thing. And I'm finding more often than not, they are excited to actually get in internally and come up with the cash to make this thing, which is a great opportunity for creatives.
You hear this? Is that we are given so much opportunity and so much power as writers and creators in advertising that we have these tools and this media available to us to change minds. So anytime you can find an opportunity to do that that's beyond just business, I think is really inspiring. Like, as a writer, junior copywriter, you're pretty powerful. You have the world as your canvas. So take advantage of that and leave something, you know, behind.
Absolutely, and ideas can come from anywhere. So when you're at an agency, you know, you can submit stuff that ends up getting produced and ends up helping people around the world. I guess, Will, did you want to say one more thing?
Yeah, I totally agree. I mean, when you guys get briefs, regardless of what the media might be, just see if there's an opportunity there for a deeper message that you want to tell, you know, that you want to convey a deeper story. And again, it's that crossroads of, we talked about, like, a lot of times it may be difficult getting an idea produced because there are realities and practical aspects of getting things produced, whether it's a budget thing and all these other obstacles. But if you really talk to the client about this, really comes out of the truth of your brand and come at it from that point, as opposed to defending the work creatively, think about it from a strategic and a business standpoint, I think you'll gain a lot of trust with clients.
Yeah, hard to arrange in Tanzania, right?
Did
Andreas, for the final word.
Just building on what these guys said, I think the other thing is not just kind of looking at the messaging and the brief differently from that dimension, also look at where does it live, you know? Like, there's so many tools and so many options to go after creatively right now. So, you know, reinvent what it can look like. And sometimes that's the best way to actually kind of sell an idea and not go after the TV brief or change the TV brief into something that looks like an installation out in the world or an app or something else. So go beyond the brief, I think, also as far as kind of where it lives and break kind of the format of advertising, you know?
Oh, that's an excellent way to end things. I want to thank all the panelists and thank you for your wonderful work that was shown here today. And I think it changed a lot of minds and helped a lot of people. They can't do anything better than that, right? Okay.
I just want to make a one more comment. Can we please give another round of applause for this panel? They're amazing. I know that, and it was so great of them to give up their time this morning. We're now going to start the two mentoring sessions as well as portfolio reviews. So for those of you who are in the mentoring sessions, you'll stay upstairs. For those of you who are having your portfolio reviews, you'll go downstairs. All right? And we'll see you there. Thank you.